fine morning when I talk to you on a platform, virtually, of course. We are actually doing this FDP under the AACT sponsorship exactly 10 years after. What we had as an AACT FDP itself in 2011. That time we did it on the operation and testing of power system components. And from there, naturally, we have gone and grown further, especially in the multitudes, in the dimensions and features. Components which are important now. We have made the power system so versatile that it involves a lot of computing, communication, in addition to what we had in our power system technology. And above all these, the much more rigorous growth has come in its marketing. There is a fabulous power system market which exists outside. So involving all this into one platform has actually made power systems one of the vibrant and the, what is it, multi-dimensional topic of research. It involves everything. It involves economics, it involves science, it involves computational aspect, computing systems and communication systems and whatnot. So you can also see from the schedule of the FDP, which was well prepared much before the beginning of the FDP itself, that it involves all these components. It involves the power electronics, communication, computing, peer-to-peer trading, then testing, safety factors, everything. So we are trying to give you a perfect blend of everything and make you well acquainted with what is the current trend in this field. And experts that are lined up are all really eminent enough and will be telling you the cutting edge of each of these factors. I hope to have this as a perfect platform for all of us to have interactions. I'm also one among you, so we'll have best interaction among ourselves. But I'll take this opportunity to welcome the eminent persons. And first of all, I would like to welcome our principal, Dr. Shaul Hamid. He is the pillar behind every activity that comes up in our college. And he is one of the greatest supporters of such activities, especially anything that moves towards academics is the first person to support us. And I take this opportunity to welcome him to this inaugural function. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Bill. Thank you.
The second, I would welcome our yes, sir. He's also a coordinator of the FDP. He is the person who is basically a control system engineer, but has become a real power system man now. And he has in his pocket everything. On one pocket, he has power system. On one pocket, control system. On a third pocket, he has machine learning and reinforcement learning and all those. So I take this opportunity to welcome yes, sir, also. Great to see you and
thank you,
sir. And I take and I'm really proud to welcome all the delegates who have come over here from all over the country, taking this opportunity to use the virtual platform. I welcome all the delegates, and I hope that all of you will be enjoying every session that has been scheduled. Of course, the man behind, the man who has been running inside the virtual platform as well as outside the virtual platform, Dr. Matthew. Welcome, Dr. Matthew, and I really congratulate you for the way you have arranged this and looking forward to the best deliberation among the participants and the speakers. Welcome, Matthew.
Thank you.
I'd welcome all our students and faculty who have joined and hope to have the best week of December. especially because this becomes part of our energy conservation, energy safety awareness week also. So let us make use of this opportunity for that also. Thank you and welcome everyone.
Thank you, Ms. for those amiable thoughts. Now, we cordially invite our respected principal, Dr. Shahul Hamid TA, for the inaugural address.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. Head of the department and my dear colleague, Dr. Bijina, and Dr. Matthew, other delegates as well, participants of this FCT, ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning to all of you. This is AICT Training and Learning Academy, ATEL. That's a novel venture of AICT from 2-3 years. In fact, it will empower the faculty to achieve the goals of higher education, and it will impart quality technical education in the country. That's the objective of this application. And in Tintan provides variety of opportunities for training and exchange of expressions. That is very important to share our experiences and express our ideas. That's very important. And it will really support the policy makers for incorporating training as per the requirements of our country. In the year 2021-22, 1,500 FCTs are being planned in this ATEL. And we are also, in our college, we have conducted 2 or 3 ATEL programs. This FDT, the subject chosen, planning and operations of smart grid, recent trends and developments, as we all know, it carries tremendous significance, as Dr. Bijina has rightly pointed out. It's in fact a grid with electrical grid with better automation, communication and IT system, providing a better control of power flow from generating stations to end users. So that carries very tremendous significance, no doubt about it. And incidentally, I must mention the safety and security in transmissions, which cost lives of many in Indian context and in the context of third world. Our campus fell as a victim in recent past. We all must be aware of it, or are aware of it. So any FDPs or any conferences, any deliberations of such kind must bring some changes to the system. I hope this will enable our system to be enriched, and all participants would be benefited out of it. Actually, I have seen the brochure and the faculty, the resource persons from in-house resource persons and resource persons from IIT Bombay, Indian School of Science and universities abroad. So an excellent resource persons, list of resource persons I have seen. Let me congratulate Dr. Indias Ahmed and Dr. Matthew in organizing, in taking pain in chemistry.
Of academics and research. I wish this program all success, and I declare this program inaugurated. Thank you. Thank you.
Amina.
Thank you, sir. Let's welcome, sir. Thank you, sir. Let's welcome Dr. Matthew P. Abraham, Assistant Professor, Department of Tripoli, giving us a quick insight on the topic.
Okay, so thank you very much, all, especially respected Principal Dr. Shahul Hamid for the inaugural address and inaugurating the program, and Dr. Bijina Kunye for welcoming the participants and being among us. So my role is to give a brief introduction of the program that is lined up for this week. And as the title says, it is about the planning and operations of smart grids. recent trends and developments. So we know that everything is moving into a smarter thing. So previously we had phones. Now we have smartphones. Similarly, previously we had TVs at home, but now we have the smart TVs at home. And every day these devices are getting smarter and smarter. So in the power system area of or in the grid grid aspect, we have the conventional grid. Now we have we are talking about smart grids, and it is getting smarter after every day. So this FDP is intending to look into how the grid is becoming smarter each and every day, and what are the recent trends and developments in that particular area. So we have talked with the expert persons, the resource persons in this particular area, and almost everyone has accepted at the first instant itself. So we have planned in such a way that the first two days will give a introduction of smart grids to those who are not very well versed with smart grids, and later 3 days we are going into the recent trends and developments. So that is the general plan of the 5-day FDP. And so we have 15 sessions, including the final assessment and feedback session. And so 14 technical sessions. And these 14 technical sessions are handled by 14 different speakers from different parts of the world. And out of which out of 14, 9 are from IITs, IAC, NITs, even from UK, from Northumbria University, and so on, from GEC, and from different parts. And 5 of the resource persons are from our institute itself. So that is about the speakers. And there is one general motivational speaker named Jessie Jacob. She will talk on general wellness and about storytelling. So how we can deliver a lecture like a story. So that is the overall picture of the sessions to come, and the details are provided in the schedule that is already shared with the participants. So you can go through the schedule and the timing of the sessions. And apart from that, regarding the participants, we have received around 86 registrations, and out of which around 40 are outside the host institute. And even in that, around 28 are from outside Kerala. So it's a good thing that we have the participants starting from Jammu and Kashmir. So I have seen some participants from Jammu and Kashmir, even from Gujarat. We have from Telangana, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu. So we have the participants from different parts of India. So that is great to see. And so that is the overall picture. And the request that I have is to be active in each of the sessions, and you take this as opportunity to interact with the experts, and you can gain a lot from these sessions. So that is the overall picture. So I'm stopping. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Let's welcome Dr. T.P. Imtiaz Ahmed, Professor, Department of Tripoli, for the deliverance of vote of thanks.
Hello, good morning. Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
So, good morning, everyone. Principal Dr. Shaul Hamid, Dr. Bijina, Dr. Matthew, my colleagues, delegates from various parts of India. Good morning. So regarding FDPs and research, when I was a student, like 30 years back, my feeling was, why should we have FDPs? Why should people do research? Because isn't it a waste of time? Okay, because I studied in CET, we had very good teachers. I thought they're teaching very well. So if they prepare well, and if they prepare the tutorials and it'll be better for the student community. All this research and FDPs, isn't it a waste of time? I stand corrected, waste of time and money, because government is putting a lot of money for research programs and FDP. I stand corrected, like as I grow older, I realize that literature or unlike other branches, I don't know much about other branches, engineering is evolving every day. So we learned, as a young student in CET, I studied only one programming language, that also Fortran. I didn't know about MATLAB. I didn't know about machine learning. So we learn all these things. We have to keep on updating. So that is the relevance of the FDP. That is the relevance of research. When we do research, when we actually do something, then only we learn new things. And our teachers should know new things. Because if you don't know what is happening in power system, what is happening in smart grid, as Dr. Matthew rightly pointed out, every day it is becoming smarter. And if you have to be confident and stand in front of our students, and if you are leaders, and if you have to frame syllabuses, if you have to design curriculums, we should know, we should keep on updating. That is so the starting point of updation is these FDPs. When you do FDPs, then you will learn new things, and you may get hooked to some ideas which you love really, and you may do research in those areas. So I would appeal to all participants to utilize this opportunity to update yourself, to know about. We had a tough time because, as Dr. Matthew said, we want to have the best programs. We want to have best scientists and researchers to deliver the lectures. So we had a tough time because for many teachers, including Dr. Matthew, I wanted two sessions for him. I know his capabilities. I know about game theory and many others. We wanted two, but the thing is that we want to give an exposure to all the delegates about our different areas of research and different faculty members across India. Okay, so that is why we came up with this schedule. We wanted some more tutorials, but we thought we'll have kind of take-home tutorials. So you utilize this opportunity to the maximum, you will benefit out of it. So let me come to my task of extending vote of thanks. First, I want to thank AICT for allowing this course, for funding this program, and sponsoring most of our PhDs. Okay. Then I would like to place on records our thanks to our Honorable Chairman, TKM Trust, without whom the college will not be there, and all the facilities of the college. Our principal, Dr. Shaul Hamid, our HOD, Dr. Bijina, who has been a constant support for us for fine-tuning the schedule, for finding, because Dr. Bijina, an alumni of IIC, has wide-ranging contacts. So we utilize that to get the best speakers. And I want to place on record my thanks to Dr. Sharif of Professor College of Engineering, Trivandrum, who helped us in fixing up the schedule and getting speakers. Then I want to thank all professors, especially Professor Ankur from IIT Bombay, Professor Anubhama Kauli, Dr. Gopal Gajjar, Dr. Sarasjit Das, Dr. Selvan, Dr. Anil Kulkarni, Dr. Jayanand, Dr. and other delegates who will be taking the sessions. And I want to thank all our in-house experts. We had a tough time choosing in-house experts. I want to thank them also they'll be delivering lectures in the coming days. Last but not the least, and all the delegates, without delegates, this program will not be there. Last but not the least, I want to thank wholeheartedly Dr. Matthew, who has been instrumental in everything about this program, from communicating with the experts, planning, and everything. Okay, without him, this program would not have been there. Okay, yes, he is involved in many activities of the college, and he found time to organize such a prestigious event. So thank you, Dr. Matthew. And thank you, everyone. I don't want to take too much of your time. We are eagerly waiting for Dr. Bijna's session. So thank you, one and all. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir.
OK, so with this, we are formally closing the inauguration section. And now we'll be moving to the first session. Before that, so we would like to hear from the participants, especially the participants from outside the host institute. Maybe for the next 10 or 15 minutes we can spare for that. After that, Bijna teacher will carry on with the first session. So what I would request the participants is, if you can just introduce one after the other. So I am not calling by names. So first come, first serve. So those who are joining from outside the host institute, they can just tell their name, their institute, and if they can tell that with videos on, that would be better for us to see you as well. So it's the time for self-introduction by the participants. So I am not calling by name. So you can come up randomly and you can tell your name and your institute. So that would be great.
I am Saroj Kant Singh from ICFAI University, Jharkhand. I am a part-time PhD there, and I work in the core sector in power. My research is on human factors in complex projects and how we can deal with that. Smart grids is one area our company is also working on. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Saroj Kant Singh. We cannot hear you, Ishwar Murthy. Yeah, I think Ishwar Murthy has said something we haven't heard. Yeah, next.
Yeah, this is Pawan Kumar from Andhra Pradesh, Pragati Engineering College. I'm working as an assistant professor in this department of Tribuli. I'm looking forward to do my research area and completed my PhD. So I want to take up the smart grid as my research area. So I think this week will be a very useful week for me to consider this as an opportunity to recognize the areas in my future projects or future research process.
Okay, welcome, Pawan Kumar. Anyone else? Jagadish Chandra, yeah. You are muted, sir, Jagadish Chandra. Can you unmute yourself? We can't hear you.
Hello, I am Jagdish Chand Pandey.
Okay, we can hear.
Yeah, I am acting, I am HOD in Information Technology in Government Polytechnic Dwarhat and also acting principal in Government Polytechnic Chonalia in Uttarakhand under the Department of Technical Education. As according to the AICT guidelines, we have to attend at least 2 FDPs. So, and it also means for us for the better learning. So we are I am obliged to, means you have created such a nice program, so it's very nice to you.
Okay, welcome Jagdish sir. Others quickly, if so, so anybody else would like to introduce? Fine. So, so shall we move to the first session? So, anybody else? So, last call. Okay. So, we'll move to the first session. So, Amina, so introduce the first speaker and first session.
Moving on to first session on planning and operational power systems. The orator of the session will be Dr. Vishnakunya K, Head of Electrical and Electronics Engineering Department at TKN College of Engineering. Our beloved teacher has a long academic and research career. She is graduated from TKN College of Engineering and Master of Energetics from REC Calicut. She has doctorate in power systems from Indian Institute of Science, IEEE, IEIEPL's Joint Chapter, Kerala. Now, I would like to hand over the session to Vishnu ma'am.
Hope you can hear me right now.
Yes, yes.
So, what I'm going to do in this 1.5 hours is just to introduce those who have not been constantly in touch with power systems. We're just making a buffering between what we may have seen as power systems while learning or graduation or some little bit of post-graduations, and those who are actually doing the research in power systems or those who are planning to do the power systems, whatever they want to do in this field, most of it has been taken as the topics of discussion in this FBB. So what I'm going to do is to introduce each of those topics to you one by one. So basically, my outline will be to give you an introduction and then why so the power system planning is so important, what are the current needs, and what do we mean by the smart grids, the smart distribution systems, and then the concept of passive to active and the controlling. So this is what I have in my discussion. So basically, when we have all learned power systems, we used to have the sources, which can be hydro, where we have water reservoir, or nuclear power system, where we have the nuclear fuel, or maybe coal, where we have the thermal. Now, later on, when we went or discovered our, we started converting wind, then waste, or bio, then fuel cells, then solar, etc. So everywhere, what we did was we have a fuel of some sort, whatever may be the fuel, it can be anything. So one of the
Yeah, if you can put in the full slide, that would be.
I'll put it in. Stop sharing and then again share. Is that fine?
Yeah, that may be fine.
One second. And it won't happen, right? One second. Visible now?
Not yet.
You're not seeing me full.
So we cannot see your screen. It's not in presenting mode. Jibi sir, can you see the screen?
Oh.
Hello, sir.
Yeah. So can you see the screen of Bijina ma'am?
No, sir. No, now it's not.
Okay. I'm presenting.
Yeah, now it is coming.
Is it clear now?
But it's not in the slide mode. So maybe from current slide,
okay.
Can you put?
Let me see. Now it is.
It is coming, I think. Wait for a minute.
Should I say now? So I'll do one.
Yeah, we can see the slides in the PowerPoint, but not as a complete screen.
One second, then I'll remove my video. Switch off my video.
Actually, there is a delay between the slideshow screen. Switching in.
Visible now?
Yes. So screen is visible. It is. Maybe you can continue. That would be fine for the moment.
It's all that you are seeing the PPT, right?
Yeah, we are seeing the PPT, but so some of the space are wasted with the comments in PowerPoint. Okay. So that's the only thing. But we can see the slides. Okay, so that is fine, teacher. No problem.
Okay. So this is what. So if in that case you won't be seeing. So I'll put exactly similar to what I do as classroom teaching. Yeah. So this is what we were talking about. We are talking about the different sources, right? So whether it can be hydro or nuclear or whatever it is. And then what we do is convert those sources into electrical energy, right? And in the electrical energy, we transmit with using the transmission lines and in the distribution line to the energy consumption system. So in the conventional systems, in whatever conventional systems we had, we always used to have a demarcation between the source and the sink, or rather the generator and the consumer. So this is where we have separation. And this actually ended up long back, quite a long time back, where the nuclear or the power systems or power generations, we always used to say that this was set up at a place at a remote location. These were all at a remote locations, and our consumers were at the load centers. This is what we used to call it as load centers. And we used to have a separation between these two. This in physical distance was there. There was a physical distance in between them. There was an electrical demarcation. The circuit itself was different. So electrical separation were also there. So all the analysis that we used to do, all the analysis, whatever modeling we used to do, whatever analysis we used to do, modeling and analysis, whatever we used to do, we always had this separation coming in between. In the current scenario, whatever is the difference between what we learned conventionally and fundamentally and what is practiced nowadays, the difference between them, we have to actually see in doing any research. So that is what we are going to deal with in the whole FDP. Like what we done has gone. That is a bygone days. We don't have to look at those, or we don't have to actually practice those now. But we need to know the information. We need to know the fundamentals. We need to know the knowledge, how we did all those in those days or in those scenario. And then we have to methodize or develop a method to analyze the present things. So we are trying to bridge the gap between the past and the present. So you all those who have actually done with power systems might be remembering this word. We always talk about economic load dispatch. We were doing this economic load dispatch based on just one function, CI of PGI. This was the function we always used to talk about, where we said we have several generators who will be generating the generations, PGIs, right? And the cost at which it is being done. So what we do is we sigma of, so that I is being sigma and my cost. This was what the economic load dispatch. In that case, the part that we had, we were giving a practice on the private parts or the private were actually taken into organization for quite some time. Later on, they were also trying to be involved in the optimization process and finding out the best. So in what we were trying to do, select the generator and fix generation to be done by each generator. Fix the generation. This is what we did. Both find out the generate and how, and the cost function, which was actually specified by the manufacturer. Later on, when in fact after the Electricity Act of 2003, this is what changed the whole scenario. India, the whole change had happened in outside world much before this 2003. In fact, by 2003, many of the outside markets were matured enough to handle the situations by themselves. So then when it was the 2003, what we did was each of these generators were asked not to give us the cost. They were asked to bid for their generation. So where each of the generations or generating companies or each generating unit were giving us the bid of how much they are going to generate at what price, how much at what price. So this was the economic problem, right? And naturally the scenario went over from cost to bid. So this had actually been changed over by the beginning of our 2000s. So by 2003, India started doing it. While the other scenario which we did was the unit commitment. Hope you all remember what unit commitment is. Unit commitment is what we did, when we set select the generator and fix the generation. Similarly, the unit commitment was to fix the priority of scheduling the operation of the unit, or so that the maintenance will also be there and they can be kept ready for any hour continuously and so on. And when to schedule the scheduled switch on and scheduled switch off, and all those priority based commitment of generators were made. Now, this unit commitment in the earlier situation when it was the state-owned system, it was pretty easy. But now, when the system has changed over after 2003, everything is based on money. So if you are trying to have your scheduled outage or scheduled maintenance at some time where the price is high, you're going to lose a lot of money. A lot of money will be lost. So what happens is even the unit commitment part has become now a play involving money, right? So that is something that has been changing ever since the 2003. So that is what, again, I have written, the scheduled operations. Whatever that we are trying to do, now every generating unit has to see at what time are you going to do it. Are you going to do it at the peak hour? Are you going to do it at the off-peak hour? And if it is at the peak hour, are you going to lose the money? If it is at the off-peak hour, are you going to get the money? So on and so forth. So every schedule, everything, every single step that the generator units or the generator owners are going to take are looking at only one factor, the factor called money. Now, while doing all those, the term that comes in, reliability. If you talk about reliability, you might have seen even we were losing power in between while doing the inauguration itself. See, this is a daily business in a country like ours, in a state like Kerala also. Everywhere, we are actually adapted to the failure in power. And we are accustomed to the system and we just carry on without any problem, even if there is a power failure. So what we do, we try to face the situation by just having a laptop with some charge, or we used to have an inverter to support and so on. So all these were coming in to maintain reliability. But in the current scenario, after the Act 2003, what you have is a contract. Contract between, it can be between the generating company, contract between generating company and the consumer, or it may be the generating company and the grid operators. So what happens is, if you fail to give the supply during a particular interval to the contracting authority, to the to the person whom you have contracted with, you're going to pay the money, you're going to pay the penalty. So this penalty is the factor that has been brought in to maintain reliability. So as of now, we can say that when in the earlier days, we used to think about current and power and all the technological terms which were more predominantly driving the system. Now, the predominantly driving system has become money. It can be tariff also. Now, what the tariff is going to play is, as you know, earlier we used to have the tariff settled or decided by our regulatory commissions, right? The regulatory commissions. Even now the regulatory commissions are there, and the regulatory commissions are playing a role in fixing the tariff. But on the tariff itself, since players, the generators are changing, the demand side part is changing, the tariff becomes less relevant in the current scenario. Or rather, the tariff can drive, but tariff can drive the operating, the operating schedule or operating time of each one of the consumer or generator. So tariff is something that drives. It is not a big economic player as of now. Now, where on the other hand, like similar to what we say as bid for generator, now the demand side, the consumers can also come up with some offers. So what has happened in from the regulation to the deregulation stage? Now, instead of minimizing this, what we try to make the equation is maximize the difference between the cost of generation and rather it's actually the difference, okay? Minus is not so significant. This is what we write. Well, this is offers made by the consumers, and this is the bids by the generators or rather suppliers. So basically, from a simple economic dispatch where only player was our generation, now this has become something like this, which involves both power in the plus and the minus form. But the main player that comes in is the bids and offers. So what has become is this has become what we call as the social welfare function. And what we try to do is maximize the social welfare function rather than minimizing the cost of generation. So if you think about the whole system, like, is it better? Is it not better? There are several answers. Because earlier, when it was completely state-owned and with minimum number of private players, you know, it was more of a monopoly. It was a monopolistic market that came in. But now, with this hand, with the maximization of social welfare function, what we are trying to say, or the economists are trying to say, is that the gain will be more for everyone, provided the market is ideal. That is the major point that we have. You might remember, like the telephone system. This was the beginning of doing the deregulation. Telephone services, earlier we always used to depend on our Department of Telecom, DOT, and we used to have our land phones. And from there, we went to mobile phones. We had a lot of service providers, starting from BSNL. Then we have Bharti Airtel. Then we have Jio. So many comes in. So with so many players who came into, with so many offers from each company, now the consumers are having sufficient number of choices. And they will be choosing the most economical one for them, whichever is the best. So similarly, the deregulation concept was formulated considering that the electricity service also will be provided to consumers, making it the most economical for the persons who are using it. Well, to a great extent, we hope that it is possible. So now what we have changed over from what I said, the social welfare function, where the sources and the loads are now completely interconnected. There is no separation, because even you know that all our renewable sources, especially the solar, which happens to be the rooftop, it happens to be in the distribution side and not on the transmission side. So if you try to draw the whole power system layout, actually I tried to draw the power system layout, but then I thought it would be to show it like this. We have the network. It can be this network. This mostly may be the distribution network. This may be mostly the distribution network. But above the distribution network, you have some of the transmission lines, which may be connecting a major power stations like thermal, nuclear, or coal, or such ones, while all the others are at the distribution side, most of which would be at the 11 kV side, and some of them may be a little bit higher, while all the major things, these are at a higher level, and so that we have a transmission network also in between these and the distribution network. So this changeover, how did it happen and why did it happen? So this is a power system planning in the generation. This actually was published by the India government in the year of 2018. Now what they tried to do was, as in the outside world where the things have been revolutionized, even the India government wanted that to be revolutionized in our own country also. So they set aside a lot of plans, a lot of agenda points before the people who are actually doing the power systems operation. So what they did as the points to be taken against ahead was the development of power projects on tariff-based bidding. This is what I said, right? So this tariff, rather than, here it is tariff-based bidding, not on the, offers and bids by the players. The tariff-based bidding in the sense, the operators, now the utility, the main utilities of all the states, the electricity boards. Now what they do is they have, or they enter a market, either a power exchange or an electricity market, and based on their tariff bidding for the power projects. That all, and the major generating stations would to have the at least money in returns they want to have based on the capital cost they have actually spent, right? So something they have actually done the steps by the utilities for setting up power projects on tariff-based bidding. Then this is one of the major steps that has been taken by the India government, where we are not going for smaller power projects. Smaller power projects are on the one hand side, while it is quite necessary to sustain the operation inside a country where the population is increasing so much. Population is increasing so much to have an ultra mega project. So many of the states, if we see, there are so many ultra mega power projects coming in. Now, the advantage of them is that the power, the block of power that these particular power projects can give will be very high. And another thing is its reliability. Once it is turned on, it will be there for continuous supply. So that is one of the major points. Then they started saying, the other point that has been said is that the captive coal blocks or mines, they were not being used also. So they can also be brought into play so as to have the best benefit for all the users. So it is, even when they are being used as a point, you have to remember that nothing is allocated without looking at the economics. All of them have been made use of. All of them have been made use of, while the captive coal blocks also has been made use of, right? Then another policy that the India government has put was the hydro policy, which was done way back in 2008. Because water, we make use of our hydroelectric power plants, but we need to have a policy for using them also. So these are points which adds on to what technologists like us should be thinking about, like the augmentation of indigenous equipment manufacturing capacity. Now, this is one of the major breakthrough, I should say, that has come up. Now, why this is so is, if you look at the power plants nearby or in your state or wherever you are, you can see that most of our equipments have been imported from outside. Now, Indian government, when it is Make in India, that policy has came. So everything has to be made by India itself. So what they have tried to do is indigenous equipment manufacturing capacity has been improved. So that what has happened is, because of them, the cost of generating or cost of units or cost of equipments that we use, even the major equipments, the big ultra mega projects also, if we have indigenously made equipments, the cost will go down. Now, as I said, these are all done basically to reduce the cost of generation as well as improve the reliability and then spread it all around, right? So that is what comes in next. The renewable energy sources, as you know, we want to reduce the carbon footprint, and India also being part of the contract, we need to reduce the carbon footprint. So we need to have a lot of renewable energy sources to generate the power. So to improve, involve maximum number of renewable energy sources. This has been the policy that has been made in 2018, and we are continuing that, right? Another, nuclear power. If you remember, so we have several nuclear power projects set up in the country. And if we don't use them, those will be dead investments, right? So once we have the investment, and the advantage of nuclear power projects is its life. Like it can, you can use it for a long time. And the efficiency of using the nuclear power is much more. So if there is a possibility, if there is a chance that you can have a nuclear power plant at a particular place and have power produced with efficiency, you can go ahead with it. Because in between, you remember, we always had a point of saying that nuclear fuel is dangerous, using nuclear waste is also dangerous. How to dispose the nuclear waste, which is having still reactive capability, and so on. This issue was there. Even then, India government had made this policy to use the nuclear power also, so as to have the power supply given for all. This is the major policy. It is not that the persons who can afford to buy can have the electricity. No. Now we want every individual in the country to have a power supply, because we know that the development of any nation actually is directly related to the per capita consumption of its population, right? So if you want to improve the total development, naturally we need to supply power for all. So this is also one of the major policies that has been accepted by India government. Now, Integrated Power Development Scheme, these are the schemes which has been already started in all states. Then initiatives taken by in the distribution sector, that is a greater importance, right? Now, in spite of all the policies that we make, if we are not using an efficient system, then there is no point in using it. So whatever energy efficiency that has been expected or actually envisaged, that has been brought into as policies by our Bureau of Energy Efficiency, BEE. Now that is what has resulted in what is called an energy audit and energy audit certificate requirement for all major, or not major, also nowadays even the medium installations are requiring it, right? So what happens is, we our BEE certification has become a necessity for every engineer who is going to give the audit certificate for all those installations. And actually this has become an opening for all our electrical engineers, our young professionals who are coming up, right? So that is something that we look forward as one of the steps to improve the whole system operation, right? Other than that, there are four steps that has been suggested by the India government to put forward for energy efficiency. One is the PAT scheme, that is Perform, Achieve and Trade scheme, which is a regulatory instrument in energy intensive industries. What has been done is, unless and until they are not good at it, they will be at a loss, and they will not be given some of the benefits by the government if they don't do it properly. So that is what you have to perform, you have to achieve, and then you have to trade. So this PAT scheme is one of the major instrument that has been used to improve the energy efficiency. Another is market transformation for energy efficiency. This is done to shift the efficient appliances in designated sectors and use some of the innovative measures to make the products more affordable. Now, as you know, earlier solar power plants used to cost too much, and now the cost is coming down every day by day. So that has been possible only because of this energy efficiency, energy efficiency activities that has been taken up in our own country. Now, similarly, energy efficiency financing platform is also there, where the mechanisms that help in demand side management, that has come up in all the sectors. So all these points are currently implemented in all our states, in all our, in the throughout the country, and we are actually getting a little bit of response because of all this, the PAC scheme, the market transformation for energy efficiency, and then the energy efficiency financing platforms are there, and then the framework for energy efficient economic development. This is for the fiscal instruments to promote. So I think because of these policies, major players, especially the major financial players and major industrial players, have now, industrial in the sense, industrial or rather multinational companies have actually started investing more into energy side before much more compared to what it was before say 2018. So this is the policy change that has brought in this great work. Now, what is the renewable energy policy that the government has approved? So in another year, we have to achieve this 1.75. So 175,000 megawatt, out of which 1 megawatt is from solar, and that too from 40,000 megawatt from solar rooftops and 60,000 from the others, right? While the 60,000 megawatt from wind and 10,000 megawatt from biomass and 5,000 megawatt from small hydropower. So when the points that we discussed earlier, all of them were looking at the policies which direct effects of the policy. Now, what has happened is, because of this policy, every person who can afford to have top has actually changed. He has moved on to solar. Now, those who can actually have, wherever there is a possibility of having a wind power plant, we are going for it. If wherever there is a possibility of setting up a biomass plant, we have gone for it. Now, the small hydropower, especially in Kerala, if you see, we have major hydroelectric power plants set up earlier. Now, what we have done is, our utility, our KSEB, what they are doing is, for all the major hydroelectric power plants, the tail race water they have made use of, and they have set up small hydropower plants. So by that small hydropower plants, they are actually generating a lot more. So depending on the condition of each state, they can actually find out a method of adopting which one is more preferable for them. For Kerala, we have a lot of solar rooftops coming up because, you know, it's a predominantly residential consumer that is happening in Kerala compared to all the other states. In all the other states, if you say more of industrial loads are there, if you look at Kerala, Kerala is a state where the residential consumers are predominant for the utility. And so the 40,000 megawatt from the solar rooftops, at least a good percentage of that can always come from Kerala. While these all the other states will be contributing to the others, especially the wind, you know, it has majority of the wind power plants, which has happened in the coastal belt, southern coastal belt of Tamil Nadu. And now there are a lot of them coming up in solar from Gujarat and Tamil Nadu. And I know a lot of things have come up in Karnataka and Andhra. And naturally, there is something that we may have to look upon for our own environmental protection, which is the biomass. So overall, these are the planning policies which has actually tried to improve our situation, right? And so what I'm trying to tell you is that what technology that we require due to these policies, that are those are the ones which are the policies itself. Other than the policy, what is driving us is the climate. Because of the climate or the weather, we are making a lot of things. One, the generations naturally, if there is no rain, we don't get power if it is a hydroelectric project, right? If there is no wind, our wind power plant won't work. If there is, so similarly, if there is the climate change, demand will also change. One, we have already learned, because that is also a learning experience, the demand changing during the lockdown period. You might have seen that in most of our states where we went for a lockdown, the industries all went for a lockdown. The only load was residential load. Only load was residential load. So what has happened is the major stations had to cut down with the power generation. So this has actually eventually affected the whole economic balance, or led to an economic imbalance for all the states. Naturally, the climate or the weather is also a major player outside what we say as a policy. And this has improved in, and this has led us to think some resilience. Now, what is resilience? Resilience is the capacity to face the obstructions, face it, overcome it, and then sustain, right? And then continue to operate. So resilience is a factor which need to be looked upon while doing all these changes. We do change the policy. We do make the policies and go for renewable energy generation. We try to make use of the situation with the change in the climate. Everything is done, but we need to have resilience. In the sense, whatever happens, we need to have our power supply from the generator to the consumer maintained. So there are so many possible options, so many possible causes for all of them. For example, the technical equipment failure, the temporary disabling of energy service due to disaster, maybe the price volatility, increasing the energy cost, demand and supply fluctuations, source disruption, attack. So these are all the causes for failure of supply, or failure of, both are there. It can be failure of supply or failure of demand. Both can happen. And because of this, what will happen is our total supply system gets disrupted. So once the disruption happens, you know that once there is a major disruption, maybe if there is a, we have faced this, we are facing this now, every now and then, for flood. Then there is something called a landslide. Then we get earthquake. And you know what will happen because of them. Majority of our power transmission site gets taken away. In fact, completely swept out because of such things. So we have a complete fluctuation due to this. Now, what is that our system can do as technology experts from our side? What is that can that we can do to have the resilience against all these? This is what is also important for researchers to think. Temporary disabling also is not allowed. As I said, when we have a contract between our generator or the source and the supplier and the consumer, even the smaller unplanned outages may lead to a major penalty by the supplier. And this can also drive some people into bankruptcy. Right. So the energy price volatility, as I said, this is all more market operated. The price will be changing, and based on the price, the supply will be coming. And because of this, what happens? If you have several regions, so several areas, the power flow can be like this or like this. And sometimes if this gets failed, this has to go through. Now, when there is energy price volatility, what happens is the flow can be like this in one interval, it can be the reverse in one interval, like that. What happens is the role of generator or the role of being a supplier and being a consumer will keep on changing from interval to interval. This interval-wise changeover will naturally lead to a lot of disruptions also. Now, that disruption is what we say as resilience, right? So, in that case, how to face the resilience part? How to get the system more resilient across? Now, how to enhance the power system resiliency? Because resiliency is one point which need to be taken by every power system engineer. Please, if you are all researchers, please look at these points, because we keep on doing researches in improving the system technically. But beyond the technical aspect of improving the generating style, the improving the integrating style, we need to look upon this point of resiliency. So the three factors that comes in resiliency is the damage prevention. Now, how to prevent the damage? That is possible only by having a setting a high standards in our design, a high standard. As you know, India is one of the country where the standards are not at all maintained properly. And as real electrical engineers, you might have observed this also. There is no standard also, and the construction that we do, every now and then when we go for the construction is in a manner that to meet the demand, that's all. They don't look at whether it is for a long term or short term. So construction, we have to prevent the damage by hardening the construction. Maintenance, every timely maintenance, something that we are not bothered about. Who does the inspection? Is there a regular inspection being done? Is there an operating practice which has been a routine? There is a routine checking that is going on. Are we looking for cyber and physical security? These are the points which are very, very, very important as power system engineers to have the resiliency brought in. Remember that this is one of the factors which is very important for us. Now, similar to what we say as damage prevention, we should also be looking at system recovery. System recovery in the sense, whatever damage has happened. Okay, some happened has happened. How to come back? How to come back and do the system recovery as early as possible? So this has to be done as fast as possible to find out the damage, find out the outage management, come back in sequence, then do the asset management, then visualize it, and then do spare strategies. Always go for spare strategies. We always go for backup, right? So that backup policies are always required. Now, I know that our utilities are doing it, but the amount of doing all this or the extent of doing all this need to be improved a lot for our own Indian power scenario to become world standard. Right? It has to be globally the best. If that has to be done, we need to look at these points like the damage prevention, the system recovery, and then the survivability. Survivability is basic level of service has to be improved. The communication has to be improved. Urgent service need to be done and new business models. Now, these are the points which will be taken by many of our speakers during this FPP. How to improve all of them. And I'm sure you are going to get a lot of information on all these from all of them. Now, whatever I have been talking about till now was on the generation side. Now, there are something required on the transmission side also. Like in transmission planning, by the India government, they made a policy also very recently. Last year, they have made a policy. In that day, it is 2019. So in that 2019, what they made is new generation additions in the system. Whenever there is a new generation addition, we need a transmission line. Whenever there is an increase in demand, we have to go for planning a new transmission line. Now, then again, system strengthening that is necessary to achieve the reliability. So there comes our India government has made a policy with the word reliability. So that is what we have to see, that the policy of the government has changed. They have improved the words like reliability and resilience. So as researchers, we should now pay a lot of attention to maintaining and improving them. So who are the players coming in who would actually bring into implementation all of them? Our Power System Operation Corporation, POSOCO is one of them, which is under the Power Grid Corporation. Then they, what they look at is mostly all these interstate transmission and intrastate transmission. The interstate transmission, as you know, it is mostly by the POSOCO, while the intrastate transmission is usually done by the utility. So, and based on the regulation set up by the CEA. So what India government has made a policy is either POSOCO should say what should be the interstate transmission on each of these reasons, right? Or the intrastate transmission, the utility has to suggest based on this. And when whatever they have to say has to be maintaining the regulations published by Central Electricity Authority. So I'd like to show you some of the numbers. This is some transmission line improvements that has been estimated by our country, wherein they have shown the growth in transmission lines. See, at the end of the 11th plan, that is March 2012, then this is 12th plan, which is March 17, right? At the end of 17, then required to be added in 17 to 22. Now, this is exactly where we are now in. At the end of the plan, 21-22, we are now at this stage. And you can see what all are the envisaged things. It's not just one. It is so many things like HVDC. We are going with high voltage DC, with bipole, with higher level voltages, right? I know many of these states outside, you might have any of the high VD HVDC, but it is not there in Kerala. So we are also looking forward to have one of the HVDC coming line coming down to our own state, which is coming to Thrissur. So the HVDC lines are coming up. The total lines, the distance, you can see how much. This much circuit kilometers is what we have envisaged. Number of substations. We need to have a lot of number of substations and see the number. It is too much. Then the HVDC itself with the bipolar link capacity, back-to-back capacity, it's so much. So our India government has made a policy to improve the reliability, the resilience, and set up more and more power plants with transmission lines and so on. So while the policy has changed, we should also go for a change. Now, what is now looked upon is what we say as grid resilience. We want to have a smarter grid, reinforced grid, higher design standard, with distributed generation, with a lot of microgrids coming in, and resilient demand. Resilient demand because once our, as you remember, when I wrote the equation for the bids and offers, we say we offer by a consumer. And the consumer also has to be resilient. The consumer, once its offer is almost steady and there is a pattern, the whole market will get matured and molded in such a way that the whole system will be efficient. So that is why the resilient demand is also one of the major requirement for grid resilience, right? Now, some of the terms that comes in all these, this is actually what came long back in 2003, the power business. Many of you would have already learned it, but for those who are new to the system, I want to say, we keep on using a lot of words like open access, wheeling, trading, power exchange, smart market, etc. These are not very big terms, or these are not something which is foreign to you. They are all within us. They have all been with us. Open access is opening the transmission lines, opening our transmission lines for power to be transferred. So we have seen that if in an open access, if I have a generator at Jammu and Kashmir, and I have a company at Kerala, I can have this, right? With the open access, we have the power. And what I do by this is called the wheeling. I pump in power at one end and I take the power at the other end. Now, why are these going to affect us technically? Because the transmission system operator, he need to know, he or she need to know, there is an additional power injection, a plus P into the system at one point. At one point, maybe J and K, right? This is J and K, there is a plus. And then at the there is a minus P at another point, there is a load, right? So this has to be informed to the transmission system operator for doing all this scheduling. So that is why the open access and wheeling has actually led to a lot of technical problems also, not just economical. So, and then came the trading. The trading, as you know, now there is a power trading happening between the supplier and the consumer, which happens at the power exchange. There are some spot markets also, because the power exchange, it is major bulk power exchanges are happening, where they end up in contracts. Major contracts are made between maybe utilities, maybe between major consumers, major industries. And then even then, when there is a requirement for power, in addition to the major contract, or whenever there is a change in power requirement, we can go and buy power from the spot market. Now, what is the spot markets are also existing. So the power exchange and spot markets are now existing in India, and all our utilities now, their load dispatching unit or their transmission operators, they are having a lot of economics also coming into their every hour planning rather. Now, there is a bilateral agreement. Now, what is this bilateral agreement? As I said, when there is a major contract between a utility and another utility, it can be between a utility and a consumer. It can be between a consumer and an industry, and so on. So there, they can end up in a bilateral contract where the supplier and the consumer will be signing a contract. Now, this is also allowed in the power business nowadays. Now, the last thing that we have now coming up, you might have seen in the schedule, there is a peer-to-peer trading. So you can trade the power with your own neighbor. So if you have a solar plant or you have a wind power plant and you have some power to sell, you can sell it to your nearby, your neighbor who does not own any of those. And then you can get in return money. It can be a barter system. Also, you can give them power and you can get a product in reverse and so on. So the peer-to-peer trading is one of the aspects. And this has actually gained a lot of momentum with something like involvement of our Bitcoin system and the blockchain systems and all those. So actually, now all these computing systems have also become part of doing the trading. Now, when the optimization part that we did earlier for the trading, social welfare maximization, the optimization part, we can involve any of the machine learning aspects. So actually the computing part also, all of the computing aspects also have become part of our power systems. Now, as Matthew was introducing, everything has become smart. Why not the power system? Because earlier, when we used to talk about the term called smart grid, everybody was telling that telephones have become smarter. The railways have become smarter. Only the transmission lines are dumb. That used to be the word they used to use. Right now, we are trying to say now even we are becoming smart. Right now, the problem is when we started with the smart. With the communication and automation systems, the communication and automation was actually in islands. Like some of them used to be automated. Some of the proprietary, these are proprietary systems. These are some industries and maybe some of the major industries and the substations. Some of them may be automated, right? So little integration across the industry, across the total industry, only some part of it used to be automated. And the consumer part, most of the time, there is no integration with the consumer equipment. This used to be what we have in the situation. Today's situation also, it's not much different. So, but we are in the process of going from the earlier, the dumb system, as they used to call us, from there to the much smarter system, right? So in the smarter system, what is happening is, what is happening without the architecture? This figure I have taken from one of the smart grid plans and plans that they have published in US. So this shows the whole story, right? We are trying to improve some of them with the maximum number of things, with so many advantages, dash, dash, dash. We are adding so many features. But here, the data conversion converts everything into a bulla cart. Because here it may happen at a higher stage, but here it will be very slow. So this is a major hurdle that we face. So that is why when we want to make things into smart, everything has to be made smarter, not just one. So why do we need an architecture? Because we need to manage the complexity, especially in this case. We want to convert this, right? So we want to have, if the generations are smarter, the transmission system has to be smarter, the distribution system has to be smarter, the using demand side, that has to be smarter. Now, while doing the smarter, we need to have an architecture to design all of them so as to manage the complexity completely and enacting the goals business models, then provide the approaches to enterprise and industry level developments and documentation, understanding the synergies and problems. Most of the time we miss this opportunity to do that. Then primary approach for consistently establishing and implementing security policies. This is something that we usually miss. Because as we said, when we are trying to make things in automated, we do the automation, that part is okay, we do automated, but we have to look at one more term, the security, the network security. So that is why I said, when we are trying to talk about the complete smart grid, currently the open architecture is under refining process, but we are going for it, the complete smart grid. So our smart grid principle involves not just that, it involves everything. All the power requirement, the power transmission operator, there is a data and application he has to integrate. So while integrating, the number of operations that they come up with, which involves SCADA, EMS, and forecasting, then current, these are all terms that they use in the US, like current manufacturers, then data integration, then communication infrastructures. So as you see, it is the real complicated system. If while converting our simple system where we did not look at all those things from here to the upper level. So when they look at all of them, we need large scale integration, generation integration, which is already there. Now we need to go for the transmission operation where we go for a wide area monitoring and control. Then we need to have the substation automation, distribution system automation. And at the destination side, the distribution side, we have our distribution and our distributed energy resources integration, which is done by the automatic or the automated meter interchange, right? So all this comes into play. So what we have now, as I said, the generation side is changing, the distribution, the transmission side is changing. Now coming to the distribution side, do we have a change in the distribution side? We certainly have, right? Conventional distribution grids with no generation sets were called passive grids, right? So in the passive distribution system, the power transmission transportation was a unidirectional flow. But now with DG units, now there is a bidirectional power flow from the utility grid and to the utility grid. And so now we call this as an active distribution network, right? It can be defined as an electricity distribution network with bidirectional power flow. So more of the smarter generation, more of smarter distribution, we have active distribution networks. So here, how do we do is the system energy loss can be reduced and the system reliability can be significantly improved. And so what happens is the future network technologies will be leading the microgrids that we have to the smarter grids, right? Although we say microgrid or smarter grid with the ADNs, now naturally every single house, we can say we call it by the name a nanogrid, right? Every single home we call it as a nanogrid. So a congregation of nanogrids will become a microgrid. So when we naturally want to have an interaction with them, we need operations. So how do we operate? So we have sources, we have to have a wind power plant, a solar power plant, and then when you want to operate it, we need to have a smarter grid involving the monitoring using equipments like a measurement unit. Now why the? Because everything has to go with a timestamp, and that too connected with the satellites. Right, rather than with the earth level or terrestrial level, we need to go for a satellite timestamp and then go for the operations. So that is how we go for the operation with the ADNs. Now the other features also. Now resilience of the active distribution network, as I kept on telling the same word, the generation resiliency is one thing, the transmission resiliency another thing, the resilience of the active distribution network is the third thing that comes in. So some planning actions must be employed, right? Now we know that natural disasters and man-made attacks are going to be there. So what we need to is prepare for and minimize the consequences. So if you tell us, like, we have been facing the floods for the past 3 years continuously, 18, 19, 20, now even this year we had. So now we are preparing ourselves to face a consequence. So if you remember, Japan is one of the country who used to have a lot of disasters every now and then, and you have seen how efficiently they have prepared themselves for a building back, the recouping of theirs. So that is what even we should know, that natural disasters are possible, man-made attacks are possible. Now we should be prepared to minimize the consequences of those forthcoming disasters. So the steps that we need, as I said, hardening the rules. We need to have a lot of resource allocations. Then we need to have the coordination between every operating unit. We need to reconfigure the systems. We need to reconfigure the distribution network itself, where the sources are, where the sinks are. We need to reconfigure and restore it at the earliest as possible and repair the crew planning schemes, right? So these are things that we need to look at for resilience of active distribution networks. And these are the points that we need to look at as researchers also, like enhancing the power system reliance resilience against natural disaster. Please take it as a major requirement. This is something that I would request you to take. And some of the methods to improve the resilience, which we already do, an islanding and dynamic reconfiguration, which if you remember, the operators, our utility operators, they used to always do this. If they feel that there is a failure in one system and the other system, if they want to safeguard against that failure, they do an islanding, right? Then a multi-stage switch strategy from one to the other, which involves a lot of dynamic programming, considering the islanding and fault. So these, if you say that these are not there, these are there. These are there. If you ask any student also who is doing M.Tech, if you ask them, they'll say all these are existing. But what I want to tell you is that any technology which is existing is good, unless and until it is not implemented, there is no point in saying that we have that, right? Now the term with distribution network, and then coming down to the consumer part, the last the end user part, the demand side management. This is also a major topic that is coming up for discussion, right? Because we know demand response is done on a price based program as well as incentive based programs. Like price based, as I said, if you go for a double-sided bidding, like a bid and offer are connected and collected, and we go for double-side optimization with finding the generation, how much of generation, how much of load. That if it is done, that is called a price-based program, and we do the demand side by that. But and the program that we do is called a demand side response, right? Whereas on the other hand, we can have an incentive payments to residential and district consumer also, just to do only this, like peak load shaving, to reduce the congestion, to level the whole power consumption. So these are all terms which are already under the research topics of our current researchers, right? And the reason that in a market with incentives and appropriate contracts, the would have greater control over certain loads. And in demand side management practices, the real-time bidirectional control, real-time bidirectional control and communication. This is where our communication point of view comes in. What sort of communication are you going to make up? Because you know the communication itself is possible, several ways of communication. If you look at the projects taken up by all the utilities, they can have many sort of, it can be just based on a Wi-Fi, it can be based on WAMs, it can be based on ZigBees, so many things are coming up. But for every system, we have to identify what sort of communication is to be done in, right? And what is more necessary now is this, right? Our advanced metering infrastructure, because our demand side response, if it has to be recorded by the operator, that is required, right? So in addition to all of them, this is a major thing that we should go and look at. We need to look at a lot of advanced distribution side protection, right? Demand response, as you know, it is an economical part, while protection is another part which is required. Automatic fault location and fault management, which is also a topic which is of importance. And I know Sarasij Das will be more looking into all of them, and he will be talking about all these, how to reduce the network losses by automatic reconfiguration, because this is one of the topics that he is very good at. And the topics that you need to look at all under one roof, that is what is being envisaged in this FPP. So I would stop here saying that earlier when we used to look at our power system or our substations with a lot of towers and lines, now we have systems looking like this with a lot of blocks, just closed blocks with no humans in and around, and in majority of the case, no human intervention also. So I would stop here with a thank you note. And this introduction that I have given is basically only to make you acquainted of what are the actual topics that will be dealt in through this FDP. It is just to make you a tour across the possible scenario where you will be learning through the whole FDP. So if you have any doubt, please. Need not be even doubt also. It can be purely an interactive session. I stopped and I rushed through only to have an interaction between you and me, or even among you.
Yeah, so thank you, Vijaya ma'am, for the session. So
you have
Sending if you have
Any of the participants, if you have any questions,
any
or any
query or any interaction, just add on.
Yes,
I just took you through unique tour through all the topics that will come up in this. So if no discussion on the presentation, I'll remove the presentation. anything to discuss, that would be better. Now, I know that many of you are researchers. Some will be doing, some maybe would have already completed. Or is there any point we missed out also? That is also something you can come up with. Because I did not look at take the technical side or any circuitry side, because I know every one of who is going to come after me will be dealing with this. Okay.
No, so fine. So we will stop the first session. The feedback and the attendance link is provided in the chat box. You are requested to fill that to register. I mean, get the attendance for this particular session. And we will have the next session by Dr. Gopal Gajjar, research scientist at IIT Bombay, and he will. He'll join by 11:15. So our next session will start at 11:15. So maybe you can all rejoin by that time. Okay. So thank you very much, Bijna ma'am, for the session. So is there any official thanks, GB sir? Okay. So on behalf of the whole fraternity in FDP, I would like to thank Bijna teacher for this excellent session, which was actually like taking us a tour through the various topics that are about to come in this FDP. So thank you very much, Bijna teacher. So we will rejoin in the same link at 11:15. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Bye.